And welcome from Vienna. I have the pleasure to host the first session, the first paper out with. We have five exciting papers. Every speaker will have 7 minutes to present, and I will warn you 1 minute before the time is over. Regarding your questions, you will find on the right-hand side of your screen the Q&A tab. Please write your questions in there, and we will have two Q&A sessions, the first after the first three presentations and the second one after the last two presentations, where we have around 14 minutes to go through the Q&A. Remember, you can upvote other people's questions so that we can start from the most popular ones on top. So our second speaker will be Yang Zhong from the School of Information Systems and Technology, Claremont Graduate University, Claremont, USA. Hi, good to see you.
Hi, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Let me share my screen.
Yes, please do so. Okay, if you can still put it in presentation mode, that would be great.
Hold on. Let me do the...
Yes, perfect. Okay, feel free to start.
Okay, so hello, everyone. First of all, thank you for the opportunity. My name is Yang Zhong, and I'm a PhD candidate at Claremont Graduate University. So this is a work that I work with a team in China at Aerospace Information Research Institute, which is part of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. So the first author of the paper, Dr. Wang Shaohua, he's the leader of the team. And the second author, Liang Haojian, is also the key member of our team. And they are actually the main contributors to this study. So this paper is proposing a new method which uses the deep reinforcement learning to solve the a classic MCLP problem. And we name our method as DeepMCLP. Okay, so this is the agenda for the presentation. So for to give some background, the spatial optimization problem we call SPO has been studied for decades. It is a subset of operational research, and there are many problems, models have been defined, and it has a lot of applications as well. So these are some of the well-known problems, P-median, P-center, and the two covering problem, LSCP and MCLP. They are NP-hard problems. So as right now, we basically can solve them in one of the two ways. First is to convert them into a mixed integer programming problem, and we can solve them with a solver. And we can usually get the optimal solution, but when the problem scale is big, it can be very time consuming. And the other way is to use we call heuristic methods. So these methods will usually not give the optimal solution, but they can provide a relatively good solution in a reasonable time frame. So for these heuristic methods, the main problem is that they're relying on handcrafted rules and human knowledge. So in recent years, we all see that the deep learning techniques are really taking off in many domains, such as computer vision and NLP. So the basic idea behind these is that the computer can learn the rules from the data. So a lot of these handcrafted rules can be replaced by the deep learning model. So back to our domain, we want to leverage the deep learning to study these rules from the certain data so it can solve our SPO problems. So that is actually the direction that our team has been targeting. So for this study, we look into the MCLP problem. As mentioned, it is one of the classic SPO problems, and it was first proposed by Professor Church and Ravley in 1974. So the idea is that you are given a bunch of demand points and some potential facility locations, and the facilities has coverage radius, so it covers some nearby demand points. So the objective is to determine the best locations for a given number of the facilities to maximize the covered demand points. So with the problem, what we did is that the MCLP problem can be formulated into a Markov decision process, so we call MDP, which means that we can view the facility selection as a series of steps, and then we can define a series of states, actions, rewards within the environment. Then we can apply the reinforcement learning algorithm to train a deep learning model. Then we use the model to tell the agent how to select the facility at each step. Then eventually we have a final solution. So this is our modeling definition. And this is the pseudocode that kind of describe our training process. So basically we let the agent to select the facilities for many times, and gradually it will learn how to play this selection game and get better reward over the time. And in this model, we actually add an attention layer. I'm not going into details about it, but all you need to know is that it helps to capture some complicated relationship between the facilities and the demand points. And with this, we were able to significantly improve the model's performance. So for the experiment, we did our first few tests on synthetic data set we generated. We tried three different settings. We test a commercial solver, Grobi, and a classic heuristic method called a genetic algorithm, GA, and also compare them with our model's result. So the result shows that in terms of solution, our model outperforms the GA, and we are very close to the Grobi solver. The gaps are pretty small. And in terms of the time, we are a lot faster than both of them. We actually beat them by quite a bit margin. Then we also test the model in a real scenario. Like we place billboards in Seattle area, and we want to maximize the covered traffic volume. This is actually a very typical application of the MCLP.
You have 1 minute now.
Oh. So in this case, we have 482 demand points and 417 candidate billboards, and we run the same experiment. The results were quite consistent with the previous one, and we are better than GA and close to Grobi, and we are still the farthest in terms of time. And this is the 15 billboards and 25 billboards. And these are some visualization of all the solutions. This one's for 15 billboards, and next one is for the 25. I guess when we look at them side by side, intuitively, what it tells us is that our model makes some very similar choices compared with the other two. In conclusion, we use the deep reinforcement learning to solve the MCLP, and we leverage the attention mechanism. We train the model compared with the commercial solver Grobi and heuristic method GA. And in terms of time, we outperform both of them. In terms of solution, we are better than GA and very close to the Grobi, the commercial solver. These are some things that we can that can be done in future. So giving the algorithm more constraint and like budget limitation, facility capacity, things like that. And we can test it on a even larger scale data. And lastly, we would like to see other real world applications to further validate the model. That's all I have for today. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much to our second speaker, and let's move on to the third. Don't forget, put your questions in the Q&A. And we are welcoming now Giuseppe Samo from the Department of Linguistics at Beijing Language and Cultural University of University of Geneva. Thank you.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, and we can see your slides.
Oh, perfect. So I can start. So thanks everybody for this opportunity. And I'm going to present a work joint with Francesco Alessi Ursini, who is in the audience, about a semantic model for generic terms and place nouns. What are the place nouns that we investigate? Are the generic terms in place names? For example, square in Trafalgar Square. That tendentially describe a place name. It's a square, Trafalgar Square is a square as other type of squares. And there is a lot of literature in linguistics, also in GIS, that tries to provide different types of analysis. We focus on a semantic analysis, taking into account also some pragmatic features. For example, the type of vocabulary that is adopted when we refer to those places. The terminology, studies in terminology, suggest that we can find a general vocabulary, a specialized vocabulary, and the term. The general vocabulary is the one that we use in daily use. I live on that street. Specialized uses is when we use it, for example, in a specific context, could be a geography class. And the term is another layer that is used, for example, in technical context. In this paper, the main goal of this paper is simple, is to say that we can provide through the tools of frame semantics, that is a modeling via attribute value matrices, that this type of vocabulary can be discriminated, and there are forms of overlaps. The forms of overlaps are clear because the same speakers can use the same vocabulary items, so the lexicon, in a different context. And this is, I know whether it's too small, but this is our pipeline for our work. So we started by selecting some generic terms for the paper that you will find it in the proceedings. We only focus on based on previous literature on street, square, and alley. And then we try to get a general use by querying the BNC, the British National Corpus, and the specialized used. And we use an open source like Wikipedia, since it's encyclopedic knowledge. Then we calculated some forms of statistical measures in terms of in classic measures also in computational linguistics and in corpus linguistics. And then we move to the term use so that we can have our semantic analysis. Perfect. So we actually queried these two datasets, the British National Corpus, that is 100 million tokens, and also we took the Spike platform to get the Wikipedia corpus. And then we run a Python script in order to get the PMI, and we did also analysis with the keyword in context. Then, with respect to the term, we used the International Dictionary on Landscape Urban Planning. We did a series of steps that I will leave to the paper due to the time limitation of this presentation. And these are the results. So we will first looking at the general use, and we associate certain terms that correlates with the general use, the specialized use, or the dictionary use of the given term. So we have done the same for the British National Corpus. This is an example of the semantic feature extracted, automatically extracted, plus manual investigation. From the BNC corpus, these are from the Wikipedia. We don't go into the details. And this is from the professional dictionaries. Now, collecting these features transform in some way our term into different vectorial dimensions that then can be mapped in terms of semantic frame. And it's interesting how the same word, for example, in the case of two, might vary considerably in the content. For example, between type of uses. For example, the case of alley is extremely narrow in general use that also take into consideration books, and less narrow in dictionaries and so on. That is a nice example. So for time constraint, we can just look at how the analysis look like. So we built the frame semantics. I will refer to the paper for a bigger picture of this picture, but the idea is that there are some overlaps. And this is exactly what we were looking for. So the fact is that we automatically retrieve features for a semantic frame, and we try to map whether we found the overlaps. And by querying this type of, our quantitative research, we managed to find these overlaps that we predicted.
You have 1 minute left.
1 minute. Yes. And as a matter of fact, and this is actually the main point, is that the three type of uses can be discriminated, and they are represented in the formal approach that we use by the union symbol and the intersection symbol. Okay, so perfect. I will just then skip to the conclusion. So the idea is that it is true, and it's easy to find, to map the different usage by only looking at their distribution in given corpora. And it is nice because the combination of those three types of vocabulary can give us the semantic nature of the term that we are looking. So our goal in the next future would be to also expand to other languages and try to map a cross-linguistic analysis in the same way. Okay, I think I'm fine. Thank you so much. And I hope I was clear. There is the paper as a backup.
Thank you, Giuseppe. Thanks so much for all three speakers. And the first speaker here is Simon Scheider from the Department of Human Geography and Spatial Planning at Utrecht University in the Netherlands.
Thanks a lot. So my name is Simon, and together with Judith, we have been actually thinking about this term prediction in this paper that we are presenting. We're from the Human Geography and Planning Department in Utrecht, and you're all familiar with this term because it's used a lot in machine learning especially. And in this presentation, we want to make the argument that the term is actually really overused. Why do you think so? Well, if you're a modeler, right, you're used to probably used to answer questions about the validity of your models, right? The reasons for believing, for example, that your model's predictions are trustful. Maybe you got the question like, can a model be valid if it does not predict the future well? Now, the interesting thing is that basically, if you look at on the right-hand side on the slide, there's an example for a model, a very famous one, namely one by the IPCC. On the annual global average temperature development. And now if you look at, for example, the red line there, what you can see there is that that's a particular scenario of climate prediction. Now, we all hope that the red line is actually unrealistic, right? So unrealistic in the sense that it will never occur in the future. So basically, we want a model to predict badly, right? You see, this example shows is basically sometimes we want models to predict badly. And now the question is, why is that the case? And what does follow from this observation for talking about model validity in terms of prediction? Now, we think that the reasons for this problem have to do with a terminological confusion. And namely, the confusion between two terms, the first one being prediction and the second one being projection. A prediction in our sense is a probabilistic claim about a state in the future based on a knowledge of the current state and based on knowing also or predicting also the future boundary conditions for this model. A projection, in contrast, would be then a kind of an if-then conditional probabilistic statement about the future. For example, to assess the effects of potential interventions or actions, so a kind of a synthetic experiment where you basically control for the boundary conditions, so the if of the model, in order to know what happens if you would implement a certain action. Now, it's no chance that the IPCC uses exactly these two definitions here. And in general, actually, in the climate science, these distinctions are made. Sometimes people also call this forecast and scenario, but mean similar things with this. Now, we thought in order to prevent confusion, we would actually suggest a kind of a decision tree for making this distinction between prediction and projection. The idea is that basically you should ask yourself whether the model, first of all, models the future or the current or the past. That already would exclude projections and predictions because they're only about the future. And if you're talking about the future, then the question would be whether the boundary conditions of the model are controlled or predicted. Controlled means that you have a kind of a synthetic experiment of the model that you want to run in order to see how it reacts, or whether you're actually really probabilistically predicting the future state. Now let's apply this model to some examples. The first example would be a geosimulation model. In the geosimulation community, people understand under a geosimulation model an executable implementation of a geographic process theory. So processes could be, for example, naturalist processes or human behaviors. And it's interesting to see that actually in this community, for example, in the ABM, in the agent-based model community, the validity of a model was redefined, because people used to say that a model is actually good, is valid if it corresponds to reality. But that was changed for obvious reasons, because you have a lot of different kinds of purposes of such models. So it's more adequate to ask whether the model is adequate for its intended purpose. So what are the intended purposes of such models in geosimulation? Well, one of the purposes, of course, predicting, so what will probably happen. But other purposes are what if scenarios, so these would correspond to the projection, which can be used to explore possible scenarios or to inform decisions. But there's also more other kinds of purposes. For example, the purpose of retrodicting the past, so what may have caused a particular outcome. In this particular case, outcomes are known and boundary conditions are unknown. And or you're maybe just interested in understanding the process without actually predicting anything or projecting anything, then you basically just ask the question, what causes what? So what is the causality of a process? So all of these kinds of purposes are there and are known in the geosimulation community. Here's an example of an agent-based model that is used to project bioethanol production in Brazil based on different kinds of tax policies. So you see that actually under a certain tax policy, the ethanol production goes up. And on the right-hand side there, you see where in the country that might happen based on a particular tax, based on particular policy. And it's clear that that is an example of a projection, not a prediction, because we don't know anything about the probability of any of these kinds of scenarios, only conditionally on a particular tax or a particular mandate. Now, let's take a look at the spatial machine learning models, whether we can do the same kind of trick there, right? Can we also classify these models according to this decision tree? Well, the first problem that we have there is already that if you look at the literature there, that prediction is used all over the place for unknown aspects of data. So this is a quote here: to predict is to anticipate well-defined aspects of data that are not currently known. And that, of course, applies to everything, right, in the model. And similarly, also regarding model validity, we could think about the different kinds of model purposes that we should look at. But similarly, we have there's a problem there, because the modeling purposes are not so clear. I mean, we have these categories like classification and cluster that are known in machine learning that are used there, but basically whether they are, what would be the distinction in terms of prediction or projection is really unknown in very many cases. So let's try look at some examples. So on left-hand side here, you see traffic speed prediction using LSTM models. In the middle here, there's a spatial interpolation problem solved with a random forest and a classification problem on the right-hand side, a classification building damage. And according to our definition, only the left-hand side would really be prediction. All the other things would fall under different categories. So to conclude, originating in the climate and weather model community, we should distinguish prediction from projection based on modeling purposes. And spatial machine learning overuses the term prediction for every unknown aspect of data. And this causes a lot of confusion in terms of purposes, and thus also confusion about model validity. So the future work would consist in a taxonomy of clearly defined modeling purposes for spatial temporal information, and based on this, a clearer notion of what it means for a geospatial model to be valid. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Simon. Very well in time. So let's go to the second presentation. Please remember, put your questions in the Q&A and we will be able to discuss with Simon afterwards. Our final speaker will be Jingjing Yan from the University of Arkansas, USA. Hi, we can see your slides. Please unmute yourself and share the camera if you want. We had you there for a second. Now you're gone again.
Oops.
Yes, now we can hear you.
Can you see me?
Yes, perfect. Feel free to start whenever you're ready.
Hello, everyone. This is Jingjing, a PhD candidate from University of Arkansas. Today, I would like to present a work of assessing simulated visible greenness in different urban environments. First of all, I would like to give a brief introduction about why we should pay attention to greenness. Here are three main aspects to consider. First, urban greenness is essential in balancing the carbon cycle, absorbing the air pollution, or reducing noise pollution, and so on. In addition, greenness also has been verified to greatly benefit human physical and mental health. And it also helps to better help city planning and management. So greenness is important. So the question is, we need to know how much green we can have in our living environment. To capture urban greenness, three main methods has been promoted in recent years. NDVI derived from the center light imagery is a common index to access our greenness distribution. It can give us an overview of the overall distribution of green and non-green area from the top-down or side view. However, the humans are not birds. So due to a lack of vertical information, we have no idea about the actual greenness we obtained. Therefore, the human-centric greenness indices was proposed. Here are two ways to quantify. One is from the street view image. The other is from the simulation, the model. And the street view image gray index brings a great leap from to drag a bird view to a human view. However, the method is highly relies on the accessibility of the street view images. Besides, its update frequency also varies from city to city. Therefore, the big issue is limited coverage. It became the drawback of image-based urban greenness calculation. So there's another method is modeling. The modeling simulation can overcome this coverage problem. The viewshed greenness visibility index, for short, I call it VGVI in the later slide, and it was developed recently. And from the simulation, people can calculate urban greenness everywhere. at a human eye level. And this slide shows our concept of the VGVI. In this conceptual figure, we can see the space was generally divided into four classes from the eye level view of a person standing on the crosswalk. The model can simulate a greenness level everywhere. However, this is promising model, right? However, the performance of this model still need more effort to evaluate before use it widely. So this is right the purpose of this study. We conducted a field trip in Fayetteville, Arkansas. Fayetteville is a typical mid-sized city in the United States. And then we calculated urban greenness from the field collected the panoramas, the 360 photos, and also the VGVI model. And then we compare these two, these three routes to identify the performance of VGVI. This is this study's purpose. And here's the workflow of this study. There are three steps. The first step is to collect our data. We applied a 360 camera and a GPS receiver to collect our panoramas. And in the second step, we extract the visible greenness by the DeepMCLP V2 segmentation model. And in the last stage, we calculate our panoramic greenness visibility index, which is derived from the collected panoramas, the photo, and also the VGVI derived from the model simulation. And then we compare these two indices by the correlation. Here's the results. This is a detailed distribution and a histogram statistic of the PGVI from the photo over the city of Fayetteville. And the average PGVI for all the sampling points is 0.13, so means the average greenness derived from the panoramas is 13% for the city. And this slide shows the contribution of VGVI with a high resolution of 1 meter by 1 meter. Typically, the high, we can see from the distribution, the highest value occurs in the parks or natural areas, and the low VGVI values occur in the downtown area or the resident community, because there's lots of building can block the people's sight, so they cannot see over the building, behind the building, cannot see the greenness over there. And okay, thank you. And this slide presents a correlation between VGVI and the PGVI from the photo. And we can see a significant positive correlation, 0.5 is observed for all the sampling cases, suggesting the robustness of VGVI in simulating the visible greenness in a compact urban settings. Therefore, we concluded that VGVI is a permission index to replace the image-based greenness or make up for the disadvantage of the image-based greenness. And here's a brief discussion of this simulated greenness index. VGVI is a permission index to calculate urban greenness everywhere and also in a high resolution. And the model can adjust the parameters during the simulation, so it can offer more flexibility to allow us to examine different scenarios. And this index can also assist our planners and the stakeholders to help the resident have more exposure to the greenness. That's all of my presentation. Thank you for your time and listening. Feel free to
Thank you so much, Jingjing, for your presentation. Excellent.